BH4 versus tyrosine for low neurotransmitters and a high phenylalanine-to-tyrosine ratio.
Hi, I'm Chris Masterjohn, and I have a PhD in nutritional sciences. I am not a medical doctor, and nothing contained in this episode may be construed as medical or nutritional advice of any kind or a substitute, therefore. This episode is meant purely as scientific education. If you wish to act on any ideas presented in this episode, please consult your physician first, and never take anything herein as a reason to contradict medical advice. With that said, enjoy the episode.
Alicia C. says, can you please talk about what BH4 is, how to assess it, and ways to possibly increase it if important? The reason I'm curious is because my plasma phenylalanine to tyrosine ratio is 1.4, which is around where researchers talk about genetic problems with PAH, the enzyme, phenylalanine hydroxylase. But my phenylalanine isn't high, and I don't see any SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, genetic variations, in my 23andMe data. Phenylalanine, tyrosine, and tryptophan are all well within range on my LabCorp plasma test. My urine HbA, VMA, and 5-HIAA, which are markers of dopamine, norepinephrine, and serotonin, are pretty low in the Genova range, and I do have symptoms of low neurotransmitters after chronic illness. Interestingly, there have been times in my life where my skin absolutely would not tan and other times when it tanned easily, which makes me wonder about changes in the availability of melanin from tyrosine. I'd like to make sure this apparent phenylalanine conversion problem isn't due to cofactor deficiency, and I'm currently working on getting my iron up. Copper is good, so that leaves BH4, which I don't know anything about, but maybe you and your fabulous brain do. Thank you. So BH4 is tetrahydrobiopterin, and BH4 can basically contributes reducing equivalence, meaning hydrogen ions and electrons, kind of like NAD, which is a derivative of niacin. Or really NADPH, I guess it's more like NADPH in that it's contributing, reducing equivalents rather than taking them. But there are, NADH also does that in certain, I guess, certain reactions. FADH2 might be a better example, which is a derivative of riboflavin, but... So it's basically just another cofactor that is specific to certain groups of enzymes that can contribute reducing equivalents, hydrogen ions and electrons, in order to catalyze steps in various conversions. And so BH4 is oxidized to BH2, and then it can be degraded, but generally there's a cycle where BH4 contributes to the reaction, becomes BH2, then it needs to get reduced again. And so one of the enzymes that it's involved in is phenylalanine hydroxylase, which is converting phenylalanine to tyrosine. And so Alicia is saying other cofactors for that, the cofactors for that are BH4, iron, and copper. She's working on iron, and copper is good. And so she's saying if there's one thing left over, maybe it's the BH4, but she doesn't know how to measure BH4. And she's wondering if that is contributing to her phenylalanine to tyrosine ratio being kind of high, which suggests the phenylalanine is not contributing to the tyrosine, is not being converted to tyrosine adequately. And she's worried since tyrosine is a precursor to dopamine and norepinephrine and melanin. If her tyrosine running low could be driving that. But she notes that the tyrosine is well within the normal range on the LabCorp plasma test. Although, so Alicia, did you not get the Genova plasma amino acids? Did you get the Genova... I'm a little confused. Is the phenylalanine to tyrosine ratio from Genova ion panel? And if so, is the phenylalanine, tyrosine, and tryptophan also well within the normal range, like on the LabCorp plasma test? Because, so what I'm not understanding from this, and maybe you can reply to your question and answer it. What I'm not understanding is whether the plasma values of those amino acids are all with well within the normal range on both tests, or if there's a discrepancy between the Genova test and the LabCorp test, or if you only have the plasma amino acids from LabCorp and you calculated the ratio yourself. So that might change my answer a little bit, but I'll just try to answer without that. So if the tyrosine plasma levels are totally normal, then that does seem to argue against the ratio being a problem. However, if the urinary tyrosine neurotransmitter, tyrosine derived neurotransmitter metabolites are low, then it is quite possible that the tyrosine levels are in the middle of the normal range. Because you have like low conversion of tyrosine, but you're responding to that with low production of tyrosine-derived neurotransmitters and melanin, and so you're responding to that with low urinary metabolites. So it could be that, you know, your production is low, but your total flux through the pathway is very low. So your levels are normal, but they're only normal because your flux through the pathway is low. And so that's not the most likely response to low conversion of phenylalanine to tyrosine. Like, it's more likely that the low supply of tyrosine is going to manifest in low plasma levels, and that the low plasma levels are driving the low brain levels, which are driving low neurotransmitter levels. So I wouldn't rule out, Alicia responded. So let me just finish that thought. I would not rule out the low neurotransmitter levels being driven from the low phenylalanine to tyrosine conversion on the basis of mid-normal tyrosine alone. But I would sort of take it as kind of evidence that that's more like less likely. Okay. Alicia says, 5 years ago, I did the Genova ion and noticed this high phenylalanine to tyrosine ratio. Recently, I did the Genova organics only plus a LabCorp plasma amino acid panel, which I used to calculate the ratio and found the ratio was the same as my prior ion test results. Okay. So in the old ion, was your phenylalanine the same as in your current LabCorp, right? So what you're telling me is there's no discrepancy between the ratio on the ion test and the LabCorp test. So the question is there a discrepancy between the where the singular amino acids are within the ranges on the ion and LabCorp test? Because if there's not, then we don't have to worry about any discrepancy between the LabCorp and Genova test. And we also don't have to worry about any change over time because everything's the same. But if there's a discrepancy, then suddenly we don't know whether the discrepancy is a result of it being 5 years ago versus one being Genova and one being LabCorp, because as much as you might think that lab measurements are objective, they're not. And so what lab's measuring it, you always have to control for that. So I think that makes a difference. The easy way to get around this is, well, okay. So your original question was, what's BH4? How do you assess it? And what do you do about it? And the reality is that, the HDRI is the best place to get a BH4 test, and they can look at BH4, BH2 in the ratio. And then you can get BH4 supplements, but you have to use real high doses that are real expensive, for non-prescription BH4 to match what is used in clinically effective uses of BH4. And the main nutritional thing that you can do about BH4, and you there are things you can do nothing about, like enzyme deficiencies or something. Phenylketonuria, for example, can be driven by BH4 enzyme deficiencies as well as phenylalanine hydroxylase enzyme deficiencies. But I'll tell you, I had a client, a consulting client, who had, who was heterozygous for, I think this was from Dante, I think it was Dante Labs. I don't remember. But it was not 23andMe. It was a clinical inborn error of metabolism genetic test. And he was heterozygous for maple syrup urine disease, which is a defect in branched chain amino acid metabolism, and for phenylketonuria, which is in phenylalanine hydroxylase, which is roughly analogous to what you're talking about here. And he was very symptomatic. So I looked up the mechanisms of these two diseases and the blood markers, and his blood markers for amino acids were all in the range of what is, you know, considered normal or effective treatment of those diseases. But if you just thought through the logic of the biochemistry of what these things are doing, then that's where you saw that the heterozygosity of each of those was manifesting in divergences in the blood amino acid levels from what you would expect, not from those diseases, but divergences that you would expect if you had modest differences in your metabolism from that. And he had clinically significant symptoms that were logically related to those. And what I deduced was that he did not have the elevations in phenylalanine that would contribute, that would be involved in phenylketonuria. And so you can rule out that the high phenylalanine was a problem. However, one of the things that phenylalanine, one of the problems that it does is not only does it itself being elevated in the brain cause problems, but it also causes problems with interfering with the transport of tyrosine and tryptophan into the brain and their metabolism to neurotransmitters in the brain. And so low neurotransmitters can result from the low transport of those amino acids into the brain. And so, although all his amino acid levels were normal, because of the maple syrup urine disease heterozygosity, he had higher, you know, high-end branched chain amino acids. And because of the heterozygosity for phenylketonuria, he had higher end of normal phenylalanine, and that was, and he had, you know, lower end of normal tyrosine, and so the high he had high amino acids that would compete for tyrosine entry into the brain, and then in the brain, he probably had higher levels of those other competing amino acids that would interfere with neurotransmitter production. But also, when you get these, when you get the ion panel, you're getting a fasting test. And so that you might not have elevated phenylalanine according to the fasting normal range, but you might have postprandial spikes in phenylalanine that do exceed the normal postprandial value that you are never seeing, because when you get the plasma amino acid test, you're getting it fasting. And so what I said to him was, well, look, you can try to support this with these exceedingly high doses of BH4, but this is both expensive and an utter pain in the ass to supplement with. But basic logic would say that you should be able to correct these neurotransmitter imbalances by supplementing with tyrosine. So why don't you try that first? So we tried that first and it worked. So I would say if you think that this problem is driving low tyrosine and that's driving low melanin and that's driving low neurotransmitters, look for oxidative stress and fix it if it's there. But it's going to be way easier to supplement with tyrosine and see if that helps. So Alicia adds phenylalanine was 59 on the ion and 66.6 on the lab core. On the ion, that was basically in the middle. So it's like, the range is, 40 to 70, and it's 60. I'm rounding here. And so it's like 2/3 into the range. LabCorp has a much bigger range on the lower end. So they'll let the phenylalanine drop down to 3.8. The higher end of the range is very similar, 76.9 versus 74. I would say that if you're discounting the fact that LabCorp allows you to go real, real low, whereas Genova will catch you on the bottom end of that range, I would say those ranges are otherwise similar and that your phenylalanine levels are similar. That was a typo. So scratch that. LabCorp and Genova's ranges are almost identical and the values are too close to say they're different. So LabCorp and Genova, 5 years apart, are telling Alicia the exact same thing. Okay, I revert to my last thing. So, you can get HDRIs test for BH4, BH2 total and ratio. You can look at oxidative stress markers that could be interfering with BH4. You can continue to work on your iron. But based on the hypothesis here, you're probably going to get quicker, easier, cheaper results by supplementing with tyrosine and seeing if that works. All right. Thank you, Alicia, for your question. Hope that helps.
This episode was part of a Q&A for members of the CMJ MasterPass, where I hold monthly private Zoom Q&As for my members. The MasterPass also serves as a buyer's club with exclusive and massive discounts on your favorite premium foods and health products, including pasture-raised and wild meat and seafood, supplements, sleep accessories, water filters, phototherapy devices, and much more. If you'd like to participate in these Q&As, you can join the MasterPass at chrismasterjohnphd.com/masterpass and use the code Q&A, spelled Q-A-N-D-A, Q&A, for 10% lifetime discount. I am currently working full-time on finishing my first book, Vitamins and Minerals 101, How to Get the Nutrients You Need on Any Diet. I will let you know when I have a release date. In the meantime, you can pre-order the book at chrismasterjohnphd.com/book. Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet, has been newly released as version 1.3. This is my comprehensive system for managing nutritional status with lab tests, dietary analysis, and comprehensive intake of your signs and symptoms. The new version has a comprehensive guide to interpreting the Genova methylation panel. You can pick up your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. In my consulting, I am neither a medical practitioner nor a coach. I serve as your data analyst and your strategist. I teach you scientific principles of health and wellness, help you analyze your data, and help brainstorm actionable strategies. You can sign up for a consultation at chrismasterjohnphd.com/consultations. Please consider supporting my work at no extra cost to you by visiting my support page and making a purchase with one of my affiliate links. Some of my most popular affiliates are also listed in the description of this video with links that will give me credit for your purchase. I will try to respond to comments when I can, but my presence will be intermittent while I'm finishing my book. I hope you enjoyed this, and I will see you in the next episode.